everybody. Pray all is well. God is good, isn't he? He's good to all of us. This is Pastor TJ Robinson, and I'm just here to share a word on prayer. And I thank God for this opportunity to be able to talk, to share, to speak on a word on prayer. We this morning had our prayer call, and just so grateful for what God is doing. You know, one thing that I am appreciative of, and this is the honest God truth, that is the presence of God. And I am seeking his presence like never before. I'm not playing with it. I am asking God's blessings to be on our prayer call. And I am excited of the fact that he's really been answering my prayers and the prayers of other intercessors who are living in different homes, living in different states, different locations. And we're coming together believing God, no matter who our pastor is. Doesn't even matter. What matters at that moment when we pray is that we are praying from the place of victory, and that we are trying to get heaven's attention, believing when he says that if you just touch and agree, just need two or three of you to make it happen, I'm going to be in the midst. And so it's been happening. I want to invite you to that prayer call. We have it every Tuesday morning. This word on prayer, as I share a word of prayer, is really the icing, if you will. It's the recap. Even though I may use a different scripture to share from, but yet it's like the icing on the cake. So I want to invite you where it all begins, and that's every Tuesday, 6 o'clock in the morning. So that means you got to get up a little bit earlier. That means you got to possibly set your alarm clock. I've been doing this so long that my eyes automatically opens at the same time every day. And I'm pretty sure some of you can be a witness to that, that once you do a thing so long, it becomes automatic. We've been praying on in this manner since 2007. So this is nothing new to us. We are sharing it now on Facebook Live, but we wasn't doing that. That wasn't our aim. We was just trying to touch and agree and connect to heaven, and it has been a tremendous blessing. But I'm here to share a word on prayer, and I have been talking to you every week, trying to build a case. It's been an interesting journey. There's so much people are saying, especially as we try to make transition and trying to make right decisions and trying to make sure that we don't move too fast, or should we wait? Should we proceed? Should we stay? Should we reopen? There's so much that is being said about what we should do. I still say prayer is the answer. That is still, I'm going to stick with that. Reason I'm going to stick with that, because Proverbs 3 talks about how we, if we talk to him about everything that we do, like, you know, acknowledge him in all our ways, you know, not just things that we want to talk about, but in things that we don't want to talk about. He wants to get involved in those things as well. He will direct our paths. He will direct our path, our journey, our life. So I believe that this is the answer to waiting or trying to figure out. Because even while you're trying to figure out, we still should pray. But I have my answer. I know what we're going to do. But we're gonna just continue to believe God, of course, that healing would come to our land. But that being all that, been you know, talking to you, and me and you hanging out every Tuesday around noon, I've been talking about trying to handle this moment. I don't want this to become old news, because, you know, there's still people who need answers, people who still need to be comforting, or comfort in their homes, in their heart, in their mind. So this would never be old news, because it's progressing. So we've been talking about how to handle this moment, and it's been interesting. I've learned a lot. I hope you have learned a lot about how to get our faith to a certain level. Because again, for those who may be just jumping in, you know, we started talking from the place where Mark chapter 4, where Jesus put his disciples on blast. You know, again, and I want to reemphasize this, he did answer their prayer, even though when everything was going on, faith had nothing to do with it. And that was basically the highlight of our discussion, because they was on this boat. When they got on the boat, storm, wind, start going crazy. And once it started going crazy, they panicked. When they could not control what they was directing. And I was just talking to somebody, even about this decision to reopen. People are not afraid of Corona. If that was the case, they would stay in their house. They are afraid of, it's not the pandemic. It's when I lose my ability to control what I am directing. When I lose my job, when I lose my home, when I lose things that is dear to me. And that's what was going on that boat. They was doing the best they could, but when they started losing the boat, you know, then they panicked. And Jesus was on the same boat they was on, and he went down, woke him up out of panic, and he said, asked Jesus this question, said, "Hey man," of course, you know, I'm being cool about it, but them jokers was like, "Hey," you know, screaming, hollering, "Come on now, just put yourself in that position, and you know your answer is on the same boat. How would you respond?" You wouldn't be cool. You'd be screaming, shaking, pulling, rocking. But they woke him up and said, "Hey, do you not care that we're about to perish?" Jesus didn't even respond. He reacted, but he did not respond. That question didn't even deserve an answer. So Bible shows us that he went up, did what he had to do. He rebuked the wind and he spoke to the water, said, "Peace, be still," which we said that peace is to silence. And I believe that prayer is going to silence the mouth of panic during the pandemic. Prayer, even while we wait, now understand what I'm saying. Even while we're waiting, we gotta shut the mouth of panic. the two questions that we've been dealing with go head to head. He put them in check. He put them in blast. In our day, he threw them under the bus. So now listen, you woke me up to ask me, do I care? Knowing that I care about all of us. We're on the same boat. So now, I'm going to ask you a few questions. Why are you afraid? What got you like this? Been hanging out with you. You've been out with me for a while now. I know that faith is a gift. It is God's divine persuasion. But this shit went a whole nother way. And now, to be honest with you, and I've been trying to figure out, and I've been asking heaven to give it to me. Oh, how should they respond? They was in a storm. It looked like they was about to die. If I was on the boat, I would have been screaming. I'm just being honest. I've been screaming, Lord, help us. Probably been saying, I'm about to die. Don't let me die. Don't let me die. So I've been asking God, how were they supposed to handle this? It's kind of crazy, because he says, listen, why are you afraid? And then this is what really canceled all of that out. They didn't even have to answer the first question, because the second question knocks it out the park. He says, and you still have no faith. Why is that? Why you still don't believe? If they have an answer for the second question, it automatically answers the first. So We've been trying to figure this out. We've been talking. We've been conversating. And that's been prayer for panic. And I want to read something to you as we finish our discussion, because we're getting there. Because it is my aim. I'm going to tell you from the offset, straight out the gate. I'm going to tell you what my plan is, my hope, my prayer, my focus. That faith takes over. Not fear, not panic, but faith. Even while you're waiting for the next move, you don't have to live in fear while you wait. This is my aim. This is my goal. And I want to read something to you, which is going to take us to the next point of where we want to go. And I'm coming from Luke chapter 8. And just bear with me, because I want you to get the whole text of what it is saying. Luke chapter 8, and I'm reading starting at verse 40. And it came to pass that when Jesus was returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. And behold, this is at verse 41, and behold, there came a man named Jairus. This is an important guy, and that scripture lets us know that's because he said he was a ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet, besought him that he would come into, he sought him, he would come into his house for. He had only a daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay dying. But as he went, people thronged him. As he went, people thronged him. And a woman, at verse 43, and a woman having an issue of blood, 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any. Another situation, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood stopped. Jesus said, who touched me? When all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and says thou, who touched me? Boy, Peter was in trouble. I'm at verse 46. And Jesus said, somebody had to touch me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me. 47. And when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. And watch this, and faith exposed. And he said unto her, daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace. While he yet spake, there cometh one of the ruler from the ruler's of the synagogue's house, saying to him, thy daughter is dead. Trouble not the master. But when Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole. Verse 50 again. But when Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole. Fear not, believe only. I'm going to speak and talk and share a word on prayer from this thought, faith over fear. We've been hearing that, right? Faith over fear. First, let me start off again. We've kind of gave a foundation of how we're going to work this, right? And that is understanding faith. Faith is my willingness to remain unconditionally constant and trustworthy to the revealed will of God, even if I don't understand the original results that's going to follow this. I'm going to stay committed. I'm going to stay connected. I'm going to keep believing. Why? Because God would not lie to me. That's the driving point that's going to help us get to the point where we get to a place where we know that we don't have to live in fear. I'm talking about while all that is going on, you know, we don't have to live in fear. And understand faith and fear don't get along. They bump heads all the time. It's a battle all the time. It is the fuel. Fear is the fuel behind our panic. I was watching our governor. I live in the state of Florida. I'm in here in Orlando. And he got on, you know, right before he was talking about phase one of, he was like building a case, really, to present his evidence. And during this, his opening statements, he began to talk about facts versus fear. And he was saying the only reason we are at a standstill, because, which I agree, I'm talking about that point he was making. I agree with the fact when he said that the only reason we are at a standstill is because of fear. Fear paralyzes you. It paralyzes your momentum. It paralyzes your faith. It will paralyze your praise. It will paralyze the way you think. It will paralyze your dream. It will paralyze how you operate or how you live. It will cause you to be afraid of stuff that haven't even happened yet. Fear is a trip. And the truth of the matter is, all of us been there. all of us, if you haven't been there, you know you're not telling the truth. Since a child, since you knew what fear felt like, whether you had the fear of starting the first day of school, the fear of starting a challenge, the fear of facing something, the fear of dealing with something and not knowing the outcome, man, you know you've been afraid before. And so that's why we have to deal with this, because it's not like a light switch. You can turn it on and you can turn it off. You got to know how to deal with it. Let me say that again. It's not like a light switch. What you may be afraid of, I may not be afraid of. So you talking from that point does not help me. Teach me. Don't talk about me or downplay me, because I want to say this. Just because you are in a place of fear right now, because we already changed that, and I don't want you to get comfortable, does not mean you're not saved. Does not mean that God is not in you. But God can take over that. He can rebuke the wind and speak to the waves of your life. So we're gonna continue to use this working definition and say, hey, you know, it's my response. I have to remain unconditionally constant and trustworthy to reveal the revealed will of God. Faith don't work where his will is not known. It doesn't work, it can't work. So we deal with that. That's why it's important that we stick with this working definition that I've given, because this is going to break down. Take our time to cook this thing and cook it right. And but I don't know the original results that's going to follow, but I'm going to stick with God regardless, you know, and acknowledge him, pray for his direction. And we're just going to trust God with it. So here, faith over fear. It's almost like Jesus is giving Jairus a choice. We can stop, or we can keep going. He says you can either have fear or you can have faith. Faith over fear. And he encouraged him in a way. He didn't throw. It was a, and this is a ruler. The Bible calls him a ruler of the synagogue. So he was like, this was a leader in church. You know, he preached this. He studied this. He was telling him, I know something is dying in your house, but you gotta believe. Don't fear. Starts out by this. We get down to verse 40. Jesus is dealing with other situations across the water, and finally returns, and there are people who are waiting. People who are, for one reason or another, waiting for his return. Jairus was one of these guys. Jairus was waiting because he was running out of time. There was something that needed to be dealt with in his house. He loved his daughter, his only daughter, one daughter. And he didn't want to lose what he loved. I've been praying, I've been declaring that I won't lose anything, even if it looks like it's dying. I been declaring, I mean it. I've been putting pressure on it. Because that's what I believe. That I'm not going to lose anything. God is too big. He's bigger than Corona. He's bigger than unemployment. He's bigger than your finances. He's bigger than the government. He's bigger than the White House. He's bigger than what other people are saying. What really matters to me is what God is saying. And I've been declaring, decreeing, I ain't losing nothing. Because God promised he'll take care of me. Jairus is in a tough place right now. He's waiting. Can you imagine? Can you imagine what he's feeling like? That there's something he's racing against time, and he's like, where is he? Is he going to show up? Am I in the right place? Do I need to go somewhere else? Do I need to leave? But he waited. When he returned, the people gladly received Jesus. They was happy to see him. I don't know how long they've been waiting, but they waited for him. Can I say this? They that wait, talk back to me, on the Lord shall. I don't know how long they waited, but when he got there, they was glad to see. I believe that when God began to move, I don't care how long you've been waiting, when he shows up, you're going to be glad to see. You're going to be glad that you waited. You're going to be glad that you stayed in place. When Jesus finally showed up, they was happy. They've been waiting for his return. Jairus was a little bit different. Remember, we've been talking about the voice, and faith has a voice. Fear has a voice too. And we was talking about, if you haven't, just go back to the Fear Factor teaching. Look it up on my page or YouTube. And I was talking about how faith has a voice, and you have to learn to make his word become his voice. Well, there had to be something to Jairus, because he waited for him even while something was dying. Something had to cause him to show up, to wait for Jesus. But he was a little bit different. He was glad to see him, but when he saw him, he fell to his feet. He changed his posture. This is why he's different. His faith caused him to do something that other people was not willing to do. Other people was trying to throng Jesus, but Jairus fell. He decided that I'm going to fall at his feet. I'm going to beg. I'm glad to see him, but I am in a tough situation. And he decides, I'm going to fall at his feet. I'm going to ask him while I'm at his feet. I'm not going to ask him standing up. I'm going to ask him, because during that waiting time, can you imagine? He's probably saying, I don't know if he'll show up. I don't know if because I'm going to ask him to follow me home. I don't know if he's going to do it. I don't know what to say. What should I say? How should I ask him? I believe at that moment, he got the answer. He couldn't help but fall. He couldn't help but fall. He fell at his feet. He fell down at Jesus' feet and asked him, would he come? He worshiped and asked. I want to pin this here for every person that needs a miracle in your house. Jairus worshiped Jesus until he decided to come to his house. Here is what I need you to grab right now, and possibly even start right now, even while I'm talking. I'm not there. I'm here talking to you there. Worship will cause Jesus to come to your house. Worship will bring him to your house. Worship will fill his presence in your house. Worship has a way of doing that. I love worship. Worship, and I don't even care. Worship will bring tears to my eyes. I don't care who's watching me. I don't care. Because who's ever watching, either they're going to join me or they're going to watch. Either way, I'm going to fall at his feet. Worship will bring him to your house. Talk back to me. Worship will bring him to your house. I don't care. Worship. I don't know what people was asking Jesus at that time. The text doesn't give us the inside, the ear, to hear or see that. But we do see Jairus. Was he the only one to fall? But worship gave him a yes. I will come to your house. Worship will bring him to your house. And I don't know what you need in your house, but we all need him. And worship will bring power to your house. Worship will bring peace to your house. Worship will bring victory to your house. Especially, man, when you worship him in spirit and truth. He said, listen, all my worshipers, and he called to his worshipers. That means worship belongs to him. Your worship belongs to him. Got to worship me in spirit and in truth. It's amazing what worship can do when you do it from here, from the heart. It will cause heaven to move on your behalf. Worship will bring him to your house. And Jairus started walking. So evidently he got back up. They started moving towards his house. And all of a sudden, now watch this. Another level of faith is displayed. When a woman shows up. Because in verse 43, it talks about a woman having an issue of blood. He had a daughter who was 12, but then this woman had an issue for 12 years. The question is, even though the daughter was 12, did she have an issue for 12 years? Or all of a sudden, did she take sick? But this woman dealt with, and she just didn't deal with it. She tried to resolve it. She tried to, you know, get answers. She sought out doctors until she went bankrupt. Man, she spent all that she had until she had nothing left but her faith. She came behind him while they was walking in Jairus' house, and she reached out. Now this is, now remember, she just didn't just reach out and touch me. She had to really fight her way to get to Jesus. The Bible says she touched his hem, so which means she was in a posture as well. While others were standing, she had to, they couldn't have been walking fast because it was a lot of people. So she decided to reach for his garment. Now Matthew puts it this way. She said within herself, there go a voice. Remember I told you, and I asked you the question, what does his voice sound like? It sounds like you. God is in you. And the Bible says in Matthew that she said within herself during this moment, if I can just touch the hem. The faith said to her, when she was talking to herself, sometimes you got to talk to yourself and say, if I can do this, if I can just get to this place, if you could just give me the strength to make this happen. You know, you got to talk to yourself. Continue to talk to yourself. Continue to preach to yourself. Look in that mirror, whatever you got to do, and tell yourself you're not going to quit. It works. Because what you hear the most, you will eventually believe. Start talking to yourself until faith kicks in. Touch the hem of his garment. And immediately, all this time, she's been going to doctors. She's probably been going to other places, trying to get advice on how to handle this. But then immediately, just from touching a hem, watch this. She was made whole immediately. She reached out. Her faith reached out and touched him. He did not touch her. Practically, I'm just saying practically, he didn't know she was there. He was on his way to Jairus' house. I want to say this to you, and I'm always going to highlight points as we talk about this. Sometimes you have to touch him. Sometimes you have to make the decision, I'm going to touch him to get my miracle. He don't have to touch me. I don't have to be seen. I don't have to make an announcement. I don't have to text everybody. I just want to be made whole. And she touched him. Touching him made it happen without him touching her. Yeah. She got a miracle. Yeah. He didn't touch her. She got it by touching him. You'd be amazed what will happen when you touch him, especially when you touch him right here. When you get the kind of touch that gets his attention, the kind of touch that will cause him to ask questions. Who was that? Who's that man that's trying to, I guess, believe me that his hair gonna grow right? Because the barbershops are closed, so he's gonna decide that he's gonna lock his hair up, but yet show up and share a word on prayer to somebody who need to live by faith and not by sight. I'm just trying to make it work, y'all. I ain't trying to be nobody but what God wants me to be. Pardon me for that. Who touched me? She touched him. And it happened. Didn't give her a word. Matter of fact, she didn't want to make a scene. Here is the victory for all of us. I want y'all to get this. You might take off running. I hope you do. I hope you'll never forget this. He's on his way to your house. He is on his way to your house, but everyone who is on the same road or path to your house will get a miracle. They better be thanking God that you are a worshiper. They better be glad that they know you. staying in contact with you, because while he's on his way to your house, they're going to get a miracle. He was on his way to Jairus' house. Can we just deal with her just for a little while longer? Because I got to get to a point. Jesus said, listen now, all these people here, I'm not trying to be crazy, you know. God, Jesus had to show a human side of him. Well, it's probably even more difficult to receive him as anything else but who he was. So he said, who touched me? Peter, you know, he got mouth anyway. He said, listen, Jesus, now, you see all these people behind us. You know, first of all the disciples were like, what me? You know, I know Jesus was like, and I'm just speaking just from what, for who I am. You know, I know it wasn't you. Thomas, I know it wasn't you. You're going to doubt me anyway. Judas, I know it wasn't you because, you know, you ain't nothing but a backstabber. You're going to betray me. Peter, with his big mouth, said, now, Jesus, listen now. All these people, who can we can't even know who touched you. He like, no, somebody touched me because I felt something leave. The miracle, her faith exposed her. Because in the text, the Bible says in verse 47, the woman saw that she was not hid, and she came trembling, falling down again, worship. She declared unto him before all the people why she was there. She wasn't even supposed to be there. Her faith, her miracle exposed her. Her miracle put her out there. Sometimes Jesus will pause and stop for a moment just to talk about your miracle. He said, listen, your faith did this. Nothing else. No money. I wasn't even reaching out for you. You was reaching for me. Your faith made you whole. Go in peace. Here's when it gets interesting. It gets interesting from here. He says, go in peace. And while he's talking to her, somebody, a servant, came from Jairus' house. So evidently he knew where Jairus was. So somewhere along that road, that path, he was able to find him. Out of all the people, right? How did he know he was with Jesus? My goodness. Bad news came from Jairus' house. Now, this is what he says. There is no need to bother the master. Now, first of all, you living in my house. Think about that. You supposed to be believing God with me. You see me with him. And you are telling me not to bother after I done traveled, after all I done waited. I done waited to see him. Now I gotta wait as other people are getting blessed. Come on now, we all been there. She got her blessing, I'm still waiting on mine. She got her miracle, and I'm still waiting on my miracle. Bad news came. Something died. Faith got me to a certain point. Because faith have me wait. Faith said, wait on him. Don't move. Don't go nowhere. Faith told me to ask him. Faith told me to worship. And faith told me to be patient even with others. Faith told me to celebrate other people's miracles. Faith told me that if she can get hers, I can get mine. If they can get theirs, I can get mine. If it happened for their house, it can happen for my house. If it happened for their finances, it can happen for my finances. Faith faith, and it brought him to that point. What do you do when you get to a point when you've been believing God to keep it alive, but you get to a point where something has died? And faith brought you to a point. How do you move beyond that point? How do we believe beyond that point? When your prayers didn't answer, when God didn't come through for you, and it seemed like it's too late, when you was running out of time, and then time finally runs out, how do you move beyond that point? Talk back to me, somebody. You've been believing God this whole time, and then all of a sudden, the door shuts. How do you believe God beyond that point? It's time for him to speak now, because he heard him when he said this. He heard when he said, listen, don't bother the master no more. And the Bible said Jesus answered him. Jairus didn't have to say nothing. Jesus like, listen, I got this. He said this. He says, do not fear, only believe. Faith over fear. You got a choice to make, Jairus. I'm here. I promised you I was going to your house. I'm not going back on my word. But I'm not the God just to heal. I can bring things back to life again. And you got a decision to make. I must choose to believe. Y'all, I'm learning how to lean on him. Making a choice. And that's how I respond, because it's my response to the revealed will of God. Once I know his will, he said, I can pray about it, it's going to happen. If it's his will, so I have to learn how to pray his will for me. I made a decision. I'm going to believe God regardless. I'm going to believe him. Jairus had to make a decision. Am I going to keep walking, or am I going to prepare for a funeral? I'm going to make a decision. First of all, I gotta wrap up because I'm out of time. Thank you for listening to me. But let me just come to the conclusion of the matter. So now you got the servant who came and said, don't even bother. Why didn't you just keep walking? But now you want to follow me and Jesus. Anywho. They get to Jairus' house, make an announcement, I'm here. They already, listen, that's why even in your house, you got to set your house straight. Say, no, this is not how we're not gonna operate, because when he got home, they was already playing funeral music. They was preparing, they was making a sound to let everybody know that something died in this house. Jesus is like, listen, stop the funeral music. I'm here. I'm here to heal her. And they started laughing. How can you move from funeral music to laughter? They start laughing. Jesus said, okay, I got something for you. You don't have to go home, but you got to get out of here. Let me tell you how you get over fear. And faith going to kick in when you get everybody who's laughing at what you're believing God for. Everybody has the audacity to laugh. or even say, how can you believe that? That's not going to happen. You ain't got to go home. When I see you, I ain't going to disrespect you. I ain't going to be mean to you. But there's certain things I can't talk to you about. I'm not going to let you kill my faith just because you don't have it. Your faith do not determine what God's going to do for me. Your faith does not determine what God's going to do for me. It is my faith what's going to cause or determine what God's going to do for me. Make a long story short, when you read the text, which I've already read, he healed her, he raised her, she got back up until being dead so long gave her appetite. Lord, help me in here. Being dead so long gave her appetite. God is going to give you your appetite back. He's going to give you your joy back. He's going to give you your peace back. I'm talking about after being dead, you're coming back with an appetite. You're coming back hungry for him. That's why I love this. I can't wait till all of this is over. But you know what this have done for me? It has given me an appetite for his presence. It's given me an appetite for his glory. Thank you, Jesus. He's given me an appetite for him, for his power to be anointed. I want to be used by him. So I want to declare and decree that you're going to get your appetite back. I declare and decree you're going to get your joy back. You're going to get your peace back. You're going to get your power back. I declare and decree faith over fear. Everyone that says it's not going to happen, God's going to prove to them that you're going to be the last one to laugh. Not because you're laughing at them, because you had nothing to prove. But God's going to put a smile on your face, and they're going to wish they never laughed at you. Because they're going to want to participate in what God's going to do for you. And the devil is a liar. He's going to bring it back to life. And when he brings it back to life, you're going to have an appetite to live for him. You're going to say, feed me bread of heaven and feed me till I want no more. Feed me till I want no more. Faith over fear. We're going to get there. Keep hanging out with me. We're going to get there. We're going to beat this. I don't know how long. I done heard the virus being called Rona. Corona. I don't know how long that's going to last. I don't have an answer for that. But I do know this. You can have peace in the midst of the storm that surpasses all understanding. We're going to get there. I don't care if you have to keep replaying this message. Put it in your ear. Read the word. Play worship in your house. Faith has to be rehearsed. It comes by hearing, according to Romans 10 and 17, and hearing by the word of God. You must give it a voice until you be able to be like the woman. You begin to tell yourself to wipe your tears, dust yourself off, and be happy and watch God do it. I want to pray for you just for a few moments. I'm out of time. I'm going to pray for you. Ask God's choice blessings to be upon you. And then the second prayer is, because I don't want to end this, and there's somebody that needs Jesus. So if just hang out with me for a few more minutes. If you need Jesus in your life, say this with me according to Romans chapter 10. Say, Father, I come to you and I'm asking you to save me. I believe with my heart and I confess with my mouth that you are Lord and Savior, and that you died for me and got back up for me. I thank you for saving me. Amen. Welcome to the family of God. To everyone else, God bless you. I want to pray for you this prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for overcoming faith. Faith over fear. I pray for each and everyone. I pray for each and everyone that their faith fails them not. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Their faith fails them not. Thank you for the victory. Keep all of us safe. Don't allow no hurt, harm, or danger come to us, our family, and loved ones, or friends. Now, God, do what you do. Be God. Because you're that all by yourself. How great is our God? And I thank you for your choice blessings. In Jesus' name. Listen. You know, we're going to see what happens. Pray that you guys pray for this transition. As you can see, I messed around and got some. So I ain't trying to grow no dreads. That is not my style. But we want to see how this is going to turn out. I hope you like it. We'll see. Right? But I cannot say bye until I declare that everywhere you go, something good is going to happen. Something good is going to happen. Everywhere you go. There's nothing in this day. This day of the corona. Nothing in this day that this day can bring to your life, to you, your house, that you cannot handle. You're able to handle it. Yes. From the words of my mentor. Bless the highly favored of God. You're getting ready to have more than you ever had in your whole entire life. And it is so. Y'all, it's time to go to another level. It's time to go to another level. It's time to go to a greater level. I see you at the next level. All this is over. I see you at the next level. Hey, this is Pastor T.J. Robinson, Jr. A word on prayer. Live like it's real. God bless you.